What follows is Lecture 9B on political and poetic painting of the Southern Song, as we move into a period from which a lot more reliable work survives. We can begin to address certain big concerns, such as political themes in painting, in court painting especially, or poetic painting. This latter, poetic painting, means different things to different people. I myself gave a series of lectures that turned into a book titled The Lyric Journey, Poetic Painting in China and Japan. But as I acknowledge in that book, I certainly am not claiming that my definition of poetic painting is the only right one or the best one, even. In a broad sense, a lot of Southern Song Academy painting is poetic, or tries to be poetic, partly because it responds much of the time to couplets and quatrains of poetry that were set by the imperial patrons of the artists, so they were responding to that, partly because the artists knew their imperial patrons wanted poetic paintings, which are very popular in the Southern Song period in the Academy. I'll develop that theme more as we move further into Southern Song painting, but I want to keep it always problematic. It's not a quality that one can define clearly and identify easily in paintings. So now on to Lecture 9B. Now I'm going to talk about political themes in sort of early Southern Song painting, particularly the theme of dynastic restoration, which of course is a very big theme in for the Emperor Gaozong and his court, because he had restored the dynasty, so to speak, relocating it in the south. Gaozong was the ninth son of Huizong. He didn't automatically succeed to the throne. He needed to establish his legitimacy. Everybody didn't recognize it immediately. And paintings were done for this purpose, notably by, there was a Li Tang follower named Xiao Zhao I mentioned, but I'm leaving out. He has a whole series of dynastic omens, or omens that predicted and thereby, so to speak, legitimized the ascendance of Gaozong to the throne. Very good writing on this topic has been done by Julia Murray, who teaches at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. And especially, she has a book called Mirror of Morality, Chinese Narrative Illustration and Confucian Ideology, Honolulu, University of Hawaii Press, 2007. I'm going to show only two related paintings ascribed to Li Tang, probably copies, but at any rate, just to illustrate this idea of political painting being done at this time. The theme of political painting is one that I had an early seminar on. I and my students are among the pioneers in this, in dealing with this subject. And I had a chapter on it in my book called Three Alternative Histories of Chinese Painting. So if you want to read more about political painting, in my version of it, anyway, that's what it is. Okay, here now is a scroll, first please, in the Palace Museum in Beijing. I don't have good slides of it, unfortunately, but it's attributed to Li Tang, and it's probably, I think, a close copy after Li Tang. It doesn't look, the drawing of the foliage and other things don't look quite like the hand of the master. But important paintings of this kind, court paintings, were done in copies and copies by court artists to be presented to people or to preserve the composition or whatever. So in lots of cases, we have the close copy and we don't have the original. I would assume that's the case here. At any rate, the subject is two virtuous brothers named Bo Yi and Shu Shi, who at the beginning of the Zhou dynasty, way back in the, 10th, 11th century B.C., withdrew into the wilderness and starved to death rather than change their allegiance and serve under a ruler whom they saw as lacking in virtue. So they became paragons of the idea of refusing to serve the wrong ruler and starving rather than changing their allegiance. So this idea of loyalty, the idea of unchanging loyalty, is important, of course, to the new Southern Song ruler, who's still intent on, as I say, establishing his legitimacy. So here are the two brothers, one of them raising his finger as if somehow talking to the other one. They have a basket, they gather herbs,
they have this kind of a pick or hope thing over here of the other one. They gathered herbs for a while and they lived, and they finally starved to death anyway. And here you see them in the wilderness. Next, please. Here's the two of them on a somewhat better side with their basket and various other things. Okay, this is a very poignant theme for the Chinese of this time, certainly, and Chinese later. The cliff behind you can see done in something like Li Tang style axe cuts on. So presumably there's a real Li Tang painting behind this at least. Now here is the further on. It's a short scroll, ink and colors on paper, and it's important, as I say, is preserving at least a very important old composition of the kind that Li Tang must have done. Here are the two figures, large things of theirs. We don't have much of figure painting from Li Tang, so it's hard to say much about it. But it's quite fine figure painting. Date, hard to say. Maybe later in Song, maybe Yuan Dynasty, who knows. At any rate, fine relatively early painting. Expressive, strong. Well, next please. Yeah, here we go. Now, another scroll, this one in the Metropolitan Museum, represents, again, is attributed to Li Tang, and I would take it to be an early Academy copy after Li Tang again. This is the scroll, Jin Wan Gong's Return, and it was in C.C. Wang's collection and bought by Wan Fong from C.C. Wang. A good purchase, I think, an important early painting. The text comes from the Zhao Zhuan, a Zhou Dynasty text, and has to do with a ruler, the exile and the return of the ninth son of the ruler of one of the Zhou states, the state of Jin. So, since Gaozeng was the ninth son, this was very relevant to the situation of Gaozeng at the beginning of Southern Song. This is, by the way, discussed at length and reproduced in Wan Fong's book, Beyond Representation, where he gives a full and much more enlightened treatment of the painting. I'm only just putting it in as an example and speaking of it very generally. Again, the details in the painting, these large rocks with sort of shading more than texture strokes, really, and the treatment of the tree foliage and such, suggest the hand of a very good Academy master. I'm not going to try to tell the story. Here it is chariots with figures in them making their way through a mountain pass among the trees. And here, a section with two people meeting on the shore of a river or lake under a pine tree. It's, as I say, it's an important scroll, and if you read Wan Fong's text, you can see how the story goes and what these illustrated incidents really are. Next, please. Yeah, here is the main scene of Jin Wan Gong's return. He's coming to a gate attended by all his ministers and other attendants in a chariot, and here a detail of it. Fine figure painting, Academy master, presumably after a work by Li Tang. And here a section of in which you see him talking with someone else in the inside the building, inside the house, after his return. Okay, enough of that. As I say, I'm not really trying to either date it or to identify the themes more than in a very general way. Well, I should make the point here, however, that political themes and much of the rest of the thematics, the subject matter of early Chinese painting, and especially Academy painting, is to be understood, I think, in relation to the demands and the situation of the clientele, the people the artist was working for, and not the artist himself. The same is true in later times, I think. That is to say, artists who were Academy artists working in the court or outside artists, professional artists of various kinds, would choose their themes according to their understanding of what their clientele wanted, the people who were going to acquire their paintings by purchase or otherwise. And the people who acquired them wanted very often to use them for gifts, to honor somebody, or to praise somebody or whatever. They had their very, very real reasons for this. And sometimes we can construct the circumstances from inscriptions mounted with the paintings. Well, this whole idea of how to read these paintings was a big area of controversy for a while. There's still scholars who are so enamored of the idea of the free artist sort of painting whatever he pleases that they want to read the paintings that way. I think that's the wrong direction. Li Tang didn't wake up one day and say, "I think I'll draw Jin Wan Gong today." And painters of buffalo and herd boys, same way. They have a political theme which they are illustrating, and it isn't that they sort of were wandering out in the wilderness and they saw water buffalo and herd boys and, "Oh, that's beautiful. I think I'll paint that." No, that's a romantic idea which is inapplicable, I think, to court painting especially and to professional painting more generally in China. Okay, now let's go on. Now I want to show as a painting with a political content and function, a handscroll in the Freer Gallery, purchased by Charles Freer in 1919, as a work by Li Gong Lin. It's highly unlikely that it was painted by Li Gong Lin, however. I'd rather see it as the work of an anonymous professional master. This is the title, the first thing one sees on unrolling the scroll, by an unknown calligrapher with false seals. Old scroll labels, probably formerly pasted on the outside of the scroll, are at left. Next, please. Mounted after the painting is an inscription by the calligrapher Li Peng, written in 1110. And if the paintings originally went with this inscription, that would provide an early 12th century date for the paintings, maybe still Northern Song. Li Peng tells of seeing a screen painting of the same subject at the home of the great calligrapher Huang Tingjian. He, remember, was the friend of Su Dongpo, famous calligrapher and, anyway, scholar. And on this basis, he attributes the paintings in this scroll to Li Gong Lin. But they don't resemble any of the paintings more reliably associated with Li Gong Lin. As we're seeing, his name is attached to lots of old pictures to make them more valuable, more saleable. I put this scroll here among the paintings with political themes because we know that scrolls of this subject were sometimes presented to officials on their retirement. Scholar officials, even when they were serving enthusiastically in the court or in the provincial posts, were always supposed to be longing to be back on the farm, back at home. This is an enduring political myth in China, and this painting and this poem celebrate that ideal of returning home. Next, please. This is the Homecoming Ode by Tao Yuanming, as written out by a later calligrapher named Shen Hao in one of the colophons on the scroll. I put it on just for those who read Chinese to have something to look at. Tao Yuanming composed his homecoming poem in AD 206 as he himself retired from office and returned to his home in the country. It's one of the most beloved and best known of all Chinese poems. I'll read the translation provided in the Freer Gallery's documentation for this scroll while showing the successive paintings, seven of them, that make up the work and commenting on them. The next, please, the first section. The ode for this section reads, "Oh, to go home. Field and garden will be weeds. How can I not go home? Since I made my mind my body's thrall, how very sad and sorry I have been. I know not to blame what is done and gone, and I'm aware I must follow what's to come. As I've not strayed too far from the path, I feel today is right, and yesterday wrong. Far, far fares my boat with a gentle breeze. Wind whirls and swirls, flapping my robes. I ask other travelers about the road ahead, and grudge that morning's light is still so faint. Then I glimpse the eaves of home. I leap for joy and start to run. Serving boys welcome me with cheer. My young sons await me at the gate. The three trails are all overgrown, but pine and chrysanthemum remain." In this long first section of the first scroll, we first see Tao Yuanming arriving by boat. He's seen in his familiar image as if he were walking through the forest, not as if he were standing in a boat. And then on the shore, servants and others greeting him, one of them pulling the boat in by a rope, another with a mallet, probably to drive in the peg for fastening the boat. Then, at the gateway of the house and in the courtyard, we see his wife and children coming to greet him, and behind the pine trees, and presumably the chrysanthemums, although it's hard to make them out in such a picture. These are, of course, plants very closely associated with Taoyuan Ming, pine tree standing for uprightness and virtue and all kinds of things, and the official chrysanthemums because they were a favorite flower of his. Okay, the next one, please. The second painting in the scroll illustrates this next passage in the ode. Leading my children, I enter the house, where a pitcher is brimming with wine. Pulling toward me cup and jug, I pour myself a drink. Spying the trees in the courtyard, I am happy of face. Leaning at the southern window, I convey my pride. How easy it is to be content with just a little space. In this picture, we see Taoyuan Ming along with his wife and children, presumably having a drink, while two figures outside in the courtyard are doing something, I'm not sure what, a woman approaching a young man, one of his sons, carrying something on a tray. Okay, the next, please. Section 3. I pass my days in the garden doing what I please, and though I set a gate there, it's always shut. An old man leaning on his cane, I stroll and rest, lifting my head at times to gaze into the distance. As clouds aimlessly emerge from the peaks, birds weary of flying know it is time to return. But until the sun is covered and almost gone, I stroke the bark of a lonely pine and linger on. In the picture, Taoyuan Ming appears on the top of a small hill in his garden, behind a huge structure of garden rocks, leaning against a pine tree, presumably watching the sun set. He's on a kind of island separated from the rest of the garden by streams at left and right, with bridges over them. The next, please. Oh, to go home. I will cancel my friendships and cease to roam. The world and I shall put each other aside. Were I to yoke my carriage, what should I seek? I'm happy having heartfelt talks with kith and kin, dissolving my cares in the joy of zither and books. The farmers tell me that spring is near its end, and there's work to do out in the western fields. The picture accompanying this stanza of the poem shows Taoyuan Ming seated in an open building with a number of people, presumably his kith and kin, enjoying food and drink. A chin, or zither, is beside him on the floor. Servants stand in front of the building, and on the left, outside the fence, are people with horses and an ox. Maybe farmers come to see him. A man, perhaps a visiting friend, is seen arriving in lower left. The next, please. Fifth section. At times I order up my covered cart, at times I row upon my lonely skiff, exploring up the canyons, hidden and secluded, or taking rough and rugged paths across the hills, as trees happily approach the time of blooming, and the fountains bubble up and start to flow. Glad the myriad things have each their season, I am moved that my own life must have an end. In this picture, Tao is seen in his ox-drawn covered cart, accompanied by servants carrying luggage. In front of them, a wood-gatherer with a load of branches is seen coming out from the trees. Beyond, in the upper center, a boat moving off along the river or the canal, presumably carrying Taoyuan Ming and his lonely skiff. Actually, it's a comfortable passenger boat, rowed or pulled by servants. The next, please. The sixth section. All is over and done. How much longer will my body sojourn in this world? Why not let my heart decide whether to leave or stay? Why hustle and bustle about? Where is it I would go? Wealth and station are not what I desire, and I have no expectation of reaching heaven. But I cherish going out alone on a fine morning and planting my staff at times to weed and hoe. In the picture, Tao is seen in the lower left, weeding and hoeing, in one of his fields. A boy servant stands beside him, and beyond, above him in the picture, a real farmer wields a real hoe. In the upper right, an irrigation ditch with a wooden dam for shutting it off or letting it flow. And below this, a man on horseback, presumably a servant, and another beside him, both watching Tao and ready to take him home when he's done being a gentleman farmer. The next, please. The seventh and last section. I climb the eastern bank, whistling loud and long, and overlooking the clear stream, compose a poem. I shall ride with the changes until the final return, happy in heaven's decree, what is there to doubt? In this seventh and last picture, Tao Yuanming appears twice. In the upper right, where he has climbed the eastern bank and is whistling loud and long as he writes, and at the left, where he sits dangling his feet in the stream, composing a poem while gazing across at the far shore. This series of pictures, more or less following the same compositions, is endlessly copied in later centuries. This is perhaps the earliest surviving set of them. Whether these paintings originally went with the first inscription in the scroll, written, as I said, in 1110, is a question. From their style, I would take the pictures to be somewhat later, by some good Southern Song professional master. But I haven't studied the scroll really carefully. Next, please. The first inscription in the scroll, seen here, is the one written in 1110 by Li Peng, beginning, "Once at Shangu's, that is Huang Tingjian's," Huang Tingjian lived from 1045 to 1105, friend of Su Dongpo and so on, as I said, "Once at Shangu's place, I saw a small painted screen with Going Home done by Boscher." Boscher is Li Gonglin. "Its concept was simple but far-reaching, and in atmosphere it was generally similar to this painting. Shangu pointed out the figure of Tao Yuanming and said to me, 'Boscher's figure painting is at its best in this screen.'" Well, then it goes on for a long way. Whether, as I said before, this inscription originally went with the present set of paintings, and whether the text of Tao Yuanming's poem that precedes each of the paintings is also written by the same Li Peng, are much debated matters. You can read all about it in the Freer's website for Sun Yuan paintings, or in Tom Lawton's book. I'm not taking any stand on those big issues, only presenting this as a fine early version of a famous set of pictures, of which several later versions survive. Tom Lawton, in his treatment of this scroll in his Chinese figure painting book, makes it a 12th century painting, as I would, and notes that the style is completely unlike that of any painting reliably associated with Li Gonglin, so that that old attribution is to be completely abandoned or discounted. As we've seen already, and we'll see more as we go along, Li Gonglin's name was attached to lots of old paintings to increase their value. That's all for this scroll. Now let's go on. Continuing with kinds of court painting, I put on this leaf. This is an anonymous leaf, as I remember, in the Palace Museum in Taiwan. And it represents silk production, sericulture. And there may have been another leaf with rice culture beside it. These were big themes, especially in court painting. In fact, the original Gengzhi II, the sericulture and agriculture, rice culture and silk culture, that is, were made under Gaozong, and it's recorded who painted them and so forth. And my argument about that, then they were done again in the Yuan Dynasty, scrolls that are done under the Mongols, the Mongol rulers. Scrolls are now in the Freer Gallery. And then they were done again as paintings, but also printed, engraved, and widely disseminated in the Qing Dynasty by the Manchus. Now, my argument, which I made in the political themes chapter in my three alternative histories book, is that these were people who were asserting their acceptance of the settled ways of Han Chinese society. In other words, silk culture, rice culture, are things that very settled people do. On the other hand, they were separating themselves from nomadic peoples. In the case of Gaozong, he was setting himself against the Jin or Tartars, Jin nomads, formerly nomads who are occupying the north, the Jurchens. In the case of the Yuan, they were the Mongols, and in the case of the early Qing, it was the Manchus. Anyway, I made this argument, and it's been taken up by some others, and I think it's a good point about how these paintings were originated and how and the circumstances in which they were carried on. Okay, enough of that for now. At any rate, it's a picture in which you see women in the foreground doing various things to prepare silk, and then I don't know what's happening in the background. It's hard to say. I mean, I'm not clear. Somebody else can answer that. Before going on, however, let me insert here a painting of the same subject that has just come to my attention, reproduced in one of a set of books on Chinese figure painting, published in 2006 in Beijing, but not known to me until I ordered them recently from a book catalog. This is a painting similar in subject and composition to the album leaf that I just showed, depicting silk culture, women spinning and weaving in a house. This one, however, is a hanging scroll, 163 centimeters by 92 centimeters in size, painted in ink and colors on silk, and it's in the National Museum of China, the big museum on Tiananmen Square that was formerly the Chinese Historical Museum. It's an especially fine and compositionally interesting example of the Gengzhi Tu, or picture of plowing and weaving, and the composition includes both. In the upper right, oxen in the field, supplying the plowing pictorial reference, and below them, men carrying bundles and baskets of what may be rice plants in from the fields. Then, to the left of those, both men and women picking mulberry leaves to feed the silkworms. And then at the bottom of the composition, women in open houses engaged in cultivating the silkworms to get the silk and weaving it into cloth. Next, please. A detail of the lower part. The trees, the architecture, and the figures all seem acceptable as Southern Song Academy style, although I'd have to see the original to be really sure. In any case, this is a fine and unusual example of an important political subject, and it merits more attention in studies of this important political theme, pictorial theme, I mean. Gengzhi Tu paintings and prints from later centuries are in handscroll or album form. This is unusual in crowding it all into a single hanging scroll. Now, here is a painting in the Palace Museum. The Palace Museum in Beijing. A painting with a little inscription at the top, which was written by the Emperor Ningzong, who reigned in the late 12th, early 13th century, 1194 to 1224. And it's a painting titled Spinning Silk. It's a painting that shows and praises, in effect, village industry. That is to say, women are working late at night. It's late, and here's a detail of the foreground. Women are busy spinning silk on these spindles, and it has a bit of anecdotal detail to entertain their companion here. Another woman is waving her arms and shouting, presumably saying, "Look, hey, little Ignatz over there has fallen in the water. He's going to drown if we don't catch him, get him." Anyway, whatever. And you see the little boy, one of them close to the shore with his clothes off and the other sitting on the shore. Okay, so it's anecdotal, but the main theme is that these women are occupying themselves into the night, working ahead, rather than going off and resting, so to speak. A quite fine painting. And to be read in this way as an assertion of the value of village industry and so on. Okay, then here just for another one. This is actually a leaf in the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, a fan painting. But just because I had a picture of silk production, here's a picture of a woman. Here's a detail of it, which I'll put on beside it. A woman spinning silk outside the door of her cottage. This is a poor family. Over on the right, there's a boy who's doing something with his back to us. I'm not sure what's going on there. And then in the a bit closer, here's another boy looking very poor and so on, feeding a younger child with a spoon out of a bowl. So it's a poor family making their living somehow by doing silk culture. Interesting for that. The painting is not all that great. It may actually be after the Song Dynasty. The heavy contour drawing and the mechanical drawing of the leafage of the trees and so on somehow suggests a later date. Okay. Now then, another one, which I will show and then bring back later when I'm talking about Southern Song Academy masters. This painting is a hanging scroll in the Shanghai Museum. and it has no attribution. It's just anonymous, probably something like late 12th century, early 13th, something like that. Southern Sung Academy. If I were to guess at an artist, I would guess maybe Liu Shengnian, who's a figure painter of that period. There's a color reproduction of it as a frontispiece to my book, Three Alternative Histories of Chinese Painting, so you'll find it there. At any rate, the theme, here's a detail of it, of the figures. I'll bring it back later and show it with numbers of details. It's a fine painting. Now, there are two different interpretations of what it represents. The standard interpretation, which the Shanghai Museum accepts and has in its labels and so on, is that this is the person in white here, the old guy, is the Emperor Xuanzong or Ming Huang, mid-Tang, the great emperor under whose rule the rebellion broke out. He was the one who had the consort Yang Guifei and An Lushan, who rebelled against him and so forth. Okay, then he flees down into Sichuan, but then somehow returns after the dynasty has been restored by his son. And this is supposed to be the meeting when the son, who's the person in red here, the new emperor, receives his old father coming back from exile. Well, maybe so. That would be a very good political theme for the Southern Sung. That is the idea of reestablishing the dynasty after problems. On the other hand, my good friend Li Lin San had another, maybe almost more interesting explanation of it, which I'll talk about more when we come to it. I'm going to show it under Liu Songnian, or under Southern Sung Academy painting. He believes it's a story from the Han Dynasty about an emperor whose old father was too frail to go back to his old village, and because he couldn't walk or travel that far. So the emperor had the whole village brought to him, all with its people and everything, and reassembled just outside the palace gates. And the old guy makes his way out and sees his old friends in the village. It's a lovely story. I don't know, whichever one. I'll talk about that when we come to it. We'll come back to it anyway. Now, here's another just to illustrate a really fine example of political painting as it was done on the Southern Sung court. There are several large hanging scroll compositions of this kind. This is the one most often reproduced and the one I had a detail from in my scribe book. This is the painting titled Breaking the Balustrade. There's a detail from it in the scribe book. It's in the Chinese Art Treasures and so on. The story from the Han Dynasty again. A loyal minister named Zhu Yun, who's seen here at the left, clinging to the balustrade. Here, let's put the detail on, too, the horizontal detail. Zhu Yun clings to the balustrade. He is serving under this Han emperor, and he is so angry at his political opponent, whom we see over here at the far right, sort of behind the emperor, holding a kind of scepter and cringing and looking properly guilty. Anyway, Zhu Yun is so angry with him that he asks to use the imperial sword, which you see here behind the emperor held by an attendant, asks to use the imperial sword to put him to death. And the emperor is angered by this impertinent, unprecedented request, and instead orders that Zhu Yun himself be beheaded. Zhu Yun clings to the balustrade and protests his innocence, and finally another minister, the one seen here in the foreground in the center, who's a friend of Zhu Yun's, intercedes on his behalf, and the emperor relents and commands that the balustrade, which is broken in the scuffle, be left unrepaired as a memorial. We'll put on two details. The one on the right is the emperor with his two of his lady concubines were behind, empresses, and then the bad guy on the right looking properly, kind of cringing, and then the servant holding the sword. And over on the other side is Zhu Yun clinging to the balustrade and the guards trying to take him away. And a wonderful big garden rock, two garden rocks behind them, very powerfully backing them up and giving an expression to them. At any rate, a quite powerful, dramatic painting. This is a positive expression of what, in fact, was a rather awful aspect of Chinese imperial rule. That is, the emperor would encourage criticism and ask his ministers to criticize each other or criticize his own rule or whatever. But in fact, then he would exact really terrible penalties if you did it the wrong way. If you did it in a way that seemed threatening to the emperor, or you came out on the wrong side from the emperor, then, boy, you and your whole family might be wiped out. This is, as I say, a rather awful aspect of Chinese imperial rule. If you, again, if you want to find parallels to today's China, I mean, there was not too long ago, there was Mao's 100 Flowers campaign, which everybody was encouraged to criticize, come out, open up openly and criticize, and then they came out, and then they were clobbered for doing it. And nowadays, even now, in principle, everybody's encouraged to raise objections to what's going on politically, or to criticize high officials and so on. And yet, if you do it the wrong way, you end up in jail. Well, okay, as I say, I don't need to make these parallels. They're rather terrible. Just as an appendix to this section on political themes, and before we turn to poetical subjects, I want to insert a section dealing with two important subjects in Southern Sung Academy painting, both of which had political implications, although their appeal goes far beyond any political or other function. They are buffalo and herd boy paintings and fish paintings. Here, to begin with, two photographs. I wish I had a photograph of a water buffalo and a herd boy leading it, but I don't have. Somehow I was never able to get that. Way back, back in the late 1950s, C.C. Wang and I, when we were in Taiwan, we wanted to get a photograph of a herd boy riding on the back of a buffalo playing a flute, as they do in painting. So we carried a flute around with us for a while in our taxi when we were out in the country. And on one occasion, we did indeed meet a herd boy and the buffalo, and got out, and the taxi driver, who spoke the language, serving for us, actually tried to get him to ride on the buffalo's back and play the flute, seemed to, so that we could take a picture. And we offered him money for this, but he absolutely refused. We offered probably as much as his family makes in several months, but he still just wouldn't do it. He thought we were going to, I don't know what, steal his soul, who knows. And anyway, we never were able to get it, and I don't have a photograph of that kind. So you're going to have to put together the boy seen in the picture on the right, not the little girl. For some reason, little girls don't herd buffalo. And the buffalo seen in the picture at the left, put them together, in other words. But it is a very common theme in Southern Sung court painting, and I'll show some examples. We saw before the example of the signature of Li Tang, which is in the Palace Museum in, is it Beijing? At any rate, one of the palace museums. And it's a hanging scroll with autumn leaves, autumn trees, quite wonderful, and a buffalo down below mooing. And the sound, the understood sound of the buffalo somehow goes with the autumn leaves and the whole mood of the whole thing to make this kind of melancholy, pastoral, lovely effect. Okay, here's another one. Now, this is only from a reproduction, I'm sorry to say. Paintings of this kind are also attributed to Yan Zeping, Li Tang's follower. And this one is in the Sumitomo collection in Kyoto. Here's a detail from it. Now, I don't, as I say, I don't have good slides of this, but I can talk about it anyway. It's only an attribution, but it's about right. It's a Southern Sung Academy style painting. And he did pictures of this kind. And it's, again, autumn leaves on quite beautifully drawn trees. The two herd boys in this case are asleep under the trees. One of the buffalo is wandering away. The other one, with its calf, is sleeping also. So these are mood pictures, and they're quiet and enjoyable. I'll speak as we see the next one about what these pictures actually were used for, what they meant, so to speak, how we are to interpret them. Okay, there's a handscroll in the Nanjing Museum, also attributed to Yan Zeping, no signature, just an attribution, but of the period and quite fine. Four sections for the four seasons. I have slides of three of these. Here are the boy is at the right, sitting and holding something, a stick with a string on it, maybe a frog, maybe playing with a frog, something like that, tied to the string. At any rate, one of the buffalo was wandering away again with its bridle dangling from its nose, and others are behind the tree. Here's a detail of the central part. Let's see, I somehow didn't include whatever it is the boy is playing with on his string. But and then the two buffalo, or another, again, it's maybe the buffalo and its calf, behind the tree. Tree quite beautifully drawn, shaped with strokes and washes and twisting and so on. This rather loose drawing of the leaves belongs to the Southern Song period, as does the do the loose dian, or dots that are scattered around the landscape. So we're seeing a Southern Song Academy style picture from somewhere in the later 12th or 13th century, say. Okay, here's the water buffalo. These beasts are drawn quite beautifully with, they have a really understanding of the bulk, the way they walk, the way they raise their heads, everything about them. These are observed. Okay, as we go on now, here's another one in which the two buffalo are in the water and the two boys, one of them fishing with a pole and the other one, don't know what he is doing, this hand raised anyway. Now, this is a subject, as I've said, with associations of rusticity, bucolic ease, taking it easy in the country, closeness to nature, certainly, and paintings of this kind are used as political gifts or commissioned from artists to be presented as gifts. At least later, we have inscriptions attesting to this. Pictures of this kind are given to people who are retiring with the implication of, now you will be leading an untroubled life away from the city and administrative worries and such, like the cowherds. An idealized vision of what the person is looking forward to. Or a Ming example that I cite in my essay on political themes in Chinese painting. A scroll of this subject is presented to an official who is going off to take a post as a prefect, with an attached poem suggesting that the man will give loving care to the people he administers, just as the herd boy gives loving care to the buffalo. Very nice image. So they could have various political implications and would be used for various, gifts and presentations. The next, please. Here's a winter scene from the same. Again, with quite beautifully drawn trees, shaped, twisting, and then the herd boy, in this case, on the back of one of the buffalo. This is a snow scene, the winter scene, and they're tramping across the snow. And he is lying on the back of one of them just for warmth, holding the bridle to be sure, but covered entirely with a heavy straw or reed coat, warm coat, looking rather like a porcupine anyway, but that's a coat that they wear. You see in other pictures, and some kind of a cap. So he's keeping warm, and the two buffalo are plodding through the landscape patiently as they do. That's what's good about the buffalo. They're such patient, lovable creatures, besides all the benefits they bring. The next, please. Let's have to keep that detail on. Put beside it this fan painting. This is one of many fan paintings I could show, or album leaves I could show, from the Southern Song period in the Academy styles, representing buffalo and herd boys. Or here it's an older man, a farmer of some kind, anyway, scooping water from the lake or river at the right to give to the buffalo and its calf. And here the wind is nicely caught in the willow tree and in the grass down below. This is not a tribute to anybody, but I say it's one of many I could show. I've made this point before, but let me do it again before I close this section. That is, the subjects that are chosen for depiction by Academy artists are chosen according to the understood demands or wishes of the artist's patrons or clientele. He produced paintings for their use, to hang or more often to present to others. And that means that the choice of the subjects by artists of this kind are not to be accounted for by the circumstances of the artist's own life, or the artist's feelings, or the artist's experience, this sort of notion of he was out on the countryside and he saw the water buffalo and the boys and he thought, how beautiful they are, I will paint those. No, absolutely wrong way to go. This kind of romantic notion is completely inapplicable to Chinese artists of this kind. They didn't have the benefit of being able to paint pictures of that kind. If they did, that isn't what we have preserved. Okay, enough for that section. No, not enough. This is such a popular theme in Southern Song Academy style painting that I want to talk more about it and show more examples. Next, please. Here's a hanging scroll depicting two buffalo returning in the evening with the herd boy wearing his cold weather coat and hat riding on one of them. The season is late autumn or early winter. The large trees are bare. Only the smaller one in lower left has a few red leaves. The sky is darkened. An old attribution to Ma Lin can be ignored. Paintings of this kind were ascribed to him in Japan for no good reason. The painting was owned by the dealer Goro Sakamoto and was in our 1982 Sogenga exhibition. You'll find it reproduced in the catalog. It's number 22. Next, please. A closer detail. The boy carries a fishing pole and what appears to be a belt of some kind. The two patient beasts plod along docilely, as usual. It would be difficult to do a stylistic study of these because so many of them don't appear to differ much in style, whatever the period and the supposed artist. Next. In the tree high above them, two birds perch on a bare branch near their nest. These two are probably seasonal indicators, significance of which I'm missing in my ignorance of these matters. Next, please. A similar painting, shorter and less well preserved, also ascribed to Ma Lin, was also in our Sogenga exhibition, number 20, owned by the dealer Setsu. The two appear at first to be so similar in style that one might wonder whether they were originally a pair or part of a four-season series. The Setsu painting is shorter and slightly less wide, but could have been cut down. The two dealers are right around the corner from each other at Nihonbashi in Tokyo. They might have own pieces that were originally a pair or two from a set of the Four Seasons, perhaps. Next, please. I have just one detail from the Setsu painting, this one, showing the boy riding on the rump of the ox, a fishing pole stretched out behind him, playing a flute. This is what C.C. Wang and I tried to get the little boy in Taiwan to do long ago. Looking at it longer, we see that the hoofs of the buffalo were depicted quite differently from those in the other painting, simplified into strokes of dark ink. And the tail of the beast has little curls in it, and so on. There are differences, so they are by different hands after all. Next, please. In our last lecture in this series, which will be on paintings associated with Chan or Zen Buddhism, I'll show this painting, which may be by a Southern Song artist. I'll introduce them. For now, I'll say only that it probably belongs to a series of the so-called 10 ox-herding pictures. You can find one set of these, Japanese in origin and a few centuries later, reproduced and discussed in the book Zen Painting and Calligraphy by Jan Fontaine and Money Hickman, number 49, pages 113 to 118. For now, I'll say only that the pictures represent stages on the way to enlightenment, and that this one would represent the fourth stage, catching the ox. Some ox-herding pictures preserved in both China and Japan originally belonged to such series. Next. The boy with his whip has managed to get a rope attached to the ox's nose and is trying to tame the beast. Next. Mythical or real personages who figure in Chan anecdotes often ride on oxen, as in this Chan meeting picture, in which a secular figure, seen at the right, encounters a Chan adept holding a pole and sitting on an ox. Next. A whole long study could be made of the ways in which the buffalo appears in Chan paintings and what it represents. Paintings of this kind are found almost entirely in Japan, since they belong to a large class of Chan or Zen paintings that was not preserved and transmitted in China. And of course they are to be understood, insofar as they can be understood at all, very differently from the kind of political associations that paintings of oxen and herd boys often took on in China. Here is a subject for a book by somebody. Next. Now I'll conclude by showing a number of buffalo and herd boy album leaves, without attempting datings or attributions for the most part. Here to begin with is an especially fine one in the Seattle Museum, a fan-shaped leaf depicting a boy following a buffalo across the foreground with a mysterious forest of trees receding into misty distance above them. The boy holds something, maybe a bird he has caught on a stick. Next. The buffalo is more strongly modeled than usual, especially its haunches and its ribs. The boy is also drawn with unusual care and strongly characterized, shock-headed, hunched over, thin-legged, and barefoot, looking even a bit sinister, unusually for a low-class figure in a Sun painting. One would like to know who the artist of this one was. Next, please. The painting on the left is in the Tokyo National Museum and is attributed to Xiao-Guai, a great master who will be the subject of Lecture 11B. The one at right is in the Palace Museum in Beijing and is anonymous. From the style, it appears to be a late Sun work by some artist working in the late Fan Quan Manor, close to Liang Kai. Attempting datings and attributions for some of these leaves is another way of dealing with them, but one that I'm not attempting here except to mention attributions and to comment on style. This one indeed appears to have some chance of being by the great Xiao-Guai, with its middle ground softened by mist and expertly rendered with blurred brushwork, the further hills seen as rounded ridges, the nearer when shaped, the further when only a silhouette. We'll see similar passages in Xiao-Guai paintings later. More engaging is the detail of the buffalo calf at lower right, coming to join its mother as she wades into the pond with the herd boy astride her. The leaf at right is colder in all senses, with the reluctant buffalo pulled along by a rope over snowy ground. Next, please. Two album leaves from the old Freer collection, the one on the left bought by him in 1911, the one on the right in 1915. I mention these dates because the success that Freer had in recognizing and purchasing genuine and important early Chinese paintings during that second decade of the 20th century, far ahead of other Western art collectors and scholars, has recently become a matter of interest to me. The 1911 leaf was the first leaf in an album of such leaves. They were commonly collected into albums and sold as groups, but the one at right was an individual purchase. Both are late Southern Sungan date, and neither one is identifiable in style. In the left one, the buffalo calf follows its mother, carrying the boy, a misty middle distance with stream at mid-right and far distant hills in upper left are rendered effectively in graded ink washes. In the fan-shaped leaf at right, the buffalo is pulled loose from its tether and is wandering off while the herd boy dozes beneath a wind-blown willow. In my 1961 booklet on Chinese album leaves in the Freer, I speculated that this might have belonged originally to a 10 ox herding series, but now I'd see it only as a mood picture. Next and finally, please. Finally, a leaf in one of the many mixed albums of old leaves in the National Palace Museum in Taipei, the old imperial collection. This and the Freer leaf go well together. Both are mood pictures without distinctive style, and both feature wind in the willows. Wind in the willows, no literate person of my generation can say those words without arousing memories of the great children's book of that title, with its own profound evokings of remembered experiences in nature. The wind is strong and blows the branches, obscuring the more distant ones, perhaps in rain. In a later lecture, we'll see in one of a series of seasonal landscapes with travelers, the finest rendering of a rainstorm in painting known to me, and it was an especially fine genre or subgenre in the Southern Sung period. The buffalo in this leaf raises its head and moves, adding sound to the complex of sensations that the painting arouses. A farmer, bent with age or infirmity, leans on his cane and tries to call it back, a scene left unresolved. And with it, I'll close this long additional section devoted to buffalo and herd boys or herdsmen, paintings that make up another of the deeply engaging categories of Southern Sung Academy style painting. Now we'll look for a while at Southern Sung Academy paintings of fish swimming in water, beginning with this one in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, attributed to an artist named Xiao-Xiang. It's an album leaf painted in ink and white colors on silk, 21.5 centimeters in height by 25 centimeters wide. You'll find a good reproduction of it in Wenfeng's Beyond Representation book, plate 23 on pages 184-5. This painting has been a favorite of mine for many years. I always used it to show, I would show it at length and talk about Chinese paintings of swimming fish. No other artist, I think, captures so well the feeling of moving fluidly in three dimensions than these Chinese artists do. Next, please. Fish and other water creatures can move up and down as well as sideways with the freedom that we land-based animals don't have. And this capacity of fish is what the Chinese artists capture especially well, I think. When I was younger, I enjoyed swimming underwater for just that reason, risking getting water in my ears by trying to maneuver smoothly up and down as well as sideways. I was only moderately successful in that. Only fish can do it with the real smoothness, the complete escape from inhibiting forces such as gravity that fish enjoy. Next. And I use the word enjoy by intent, the sense that everybody has in watching fish in water, that they are taking pleasure in their movement, is so universal that one of the early Taoist philosophers, Zhuangzi, made an imaginary conversation around it, an anecdote known to all readers of Chinese texts, even in translation. Let me just do it from memory. You can look up the more textually accurate version of it in any book on Zhuangzi, such as Arthur Whaley's. In the anecdote, the two philosophers, Zhuangzi and Huizi, are standing on the bank of a river, looking down into the water. And Zhuangzi says, "Look at the fish, how they swim around, how happy they are." To which Huizi responds, "Since you were not a fish, how can you know whether the fish are happy?" Zhuangzi comes back with, "Since you are not I, how do you know whether I know if the fish are happy?" Huizi responds, "If, because I am not you, I cannot know whether you know if the fish are happy, then, because you are not a fish, you cannot know whether the fish are happy." Zhuangzi says, "Let us go back to the beginning." Ha ha! And it goes on from there. That's wonderful. Anyway, that's close enough. That's not a real translation, but it will do. Okay, next. A fan-shaped leaf, similar in subject and style, this one in the Palace Museum in Beijing, reproduced in the Big Book of 100 Sung Album Leaves, as number 6. The slender, supple fish portrayed in both leaves are, according to an essay by Ho Mei Sung that I'll speak about later, these fish are called Tiao Yu, a long, slender member of the minnow family, she writes, but is specifically mentioned in Zhuangzi's anecdote. This leaf is attributed to a different artist, Liu Cai. It depicts, like the one attributed to Xiao-Xiang, larger and smaller fish swimming around water plants. But in spite of the different attributions, the two could be by the same painter. Is it likely that either Xiao-Xiang or Liu Cai painted both of them? That's the wrong question to ask, I think, because in fact neither attribution means much. Xiao-Xiang was a member of the Sung Imperial House, active in the Northern Sung period. He specialized in paintings of fish. Liu Cai lived and worked a bit later, during the reign of the Emperor Shunzong in the late 11th century. He died after 1123. And there's a third Sung artist who specialized in paintings of fish, named Fan Anren, nicknamed Fang Laizi, or the Scabby Fellow. He came from Qiantang region, where the southern Sung capital was located, and he attained the rank of Daijiao, or painter in attendance, in the Imperial Academy. Most Sung paintings of fish that we have are attributed to one of these three, and the attributions seem to be made more or less arbitrarily. We can't identify an individual style for any of them. Do we have any work by any one of these three that bears a signature or seal of the artist and is safely by him? No, they are all just attributions. So the assignment of names to the essentially anonymous fish paintings is not much more, really, than an accommodation to the Chinese collector's insistence on having names attached to the paintings that they owned. We can say that all the Sung period paintings of fish we have are essentially anonymous, and most, if not all of them, anonymous Southern Sung Academy style. What we have then is a small but very impressive body of fish paintings with no single artist clearly responsible for any part of it. I begin to sound like Zhuangzi and Huizhi. Let us go back to the beginning. Anyway, my point is that the whole group is best seen as a grand collective achievement of these extraordinary masters, these three and others. Since we know that the works of Sung Academy artists were copied in large numbers outside the Academy, which is why I say these three and others, and none of these paintings bear seals or inscriptions indicating that it was done within the Academy. Should all these factors and circumstances diminish somehow the pleasure that we take in the paintings? Should gazing at them as anonymous Academy-style works, that is, make us less happy? Of course not. It should be apparent by now that recognizing individual hands and admiring originality or striking departures from the inherited style needn't have any place at all in our appreciation of Southern Sung Academy paintings and the proper pleasure that we can take from them. Once more, let me say, forget all that stuff the literati critics and theorists have been telling you. Just look long and hard at the paintings, as I've been trying to make you do by my long talks. Okay, next please. Here is a horizontal painting of two fish, ink on silk, 27 by 48 centimeters in size, that was in our Sogengao exhibition as number 38. It was owned by the dealer Yabumoto Sogoro, and it bore an old attribution to an artist named Li Tang. Nothing is known about him. He's unrecorded in Chinese sources altogether, but mentioned in a Japanese text, the Kundaikan Sayu Choki, as an artist of the Yuan period who specialized in fish. This painting, however, looks more like the work of the late Sung. It features two large fish, I think they are carp, powerfully shaped with light undersides and darker, more scaly backs. Their passage through the water seems to be swaying the water grasses, which bend as they pass, they swim by. Altogether, a striking image of two fish caught in motion. Next, please. A detail shows even more strongly how the artist has observed and captured their bulging eyes, the open mouth of one of them. We can almost feel their scaly surfaces. Next, please. I must say here that the recently published book by Ho Mei Sung titled Decoded Messages includes, as its last chapter, a long study of Chinese paintings of fish, which is by far the most complete and helpful source of information and the best interpretative essay on this subject that I know about. It's about 25 pages long and includes a dozen illustrations, all of them except one, paintings of fish, mostly in color, some of them long hand scrolls and a number of sections. She got the lavish treatment from her publisher, and she deserves it. Unfortunately, the book appeared too late for me to make full use of her information and observations, much of it based on her readings of Chinese texts. This section of my lecture just dealing with fish paintings would have been much more complete and better documented if I had had her book available as I prepared it. And the same goes for my discussions of paintings of birds and animals, all of them copiously treated in her book. Next, please. Another fish painting in the collection of the same dealer, the late Yabumoto Sogoro. This one anonymous, no attributions that I can remember, and representing three fish, the one in upper left portrayed with special skill as seen from above, turning in the water. Wenfeng points out that the cultivation of rare aquarium fish came into vogue in the time of Emperor Huizong, and he suggests that this must have encouraged the paintings of fish. Huizong's catalog, the Xuanhe Huapu, has an essay on paintings of fish and dragons. These two, fish and dragons, could be classed together because in the popular lore, the one turned into the other. Dragons could come down to earth in storms and live as fish in lakes and ponds, while fish could turn into dragons and disappear into the sky. Next, please. Fish paintings also had political meanings and usages, which are discussed at length in the well-documented essay on them by Ho Mei Sung in her recent book I've talked about, Decoded Messages. I won't give the whole of her argument, but I'll only say that in the Southern Sung, when most or all of these paintings were done, images of certain kinds of fish became, as she puts it, the symbolic images of the unbound joy of the free and unburdened life of a great man. In court circles, they must have been presented to officials to carry that kind of complimentary message. In the Ming Dynasty, as she brings out at length, a large fish, and especially the carp, leaping upward, became a well-recognized symbol for the aspirations and the achievements of a scholar official. He was leaping upward toward the Dragon Gate, the imperial capital, just as the carp leaps upward. For all this, read Ho Mei Sung's book. I can't do it at length. Next, please. A particularly fine and important example among surviving fish paintings by Sung period artists is the handscroll depicting fish swimming among falling flowers in the St. Louis City Art Museum. It was acquired in 1997 and is 252 centimeters in length. A similar scroll, closely similar in composition, so that one appears to be a copy after the other, is in the Palace Museum in Beijing. This one bears imperial seals and was in the Qianlong Emperor's collection. A section of it is reproduced in Suren Volume 3, Plate 361B. Both scrolls are reproduced in full in Ho Mei Sung's chapter. I put Suren's section beside the opening of the St. Louis scroll here, so you can see the similarity. As I've said often in this series, old and fine compositions in Chinese painting frequently exist in two or more versions. Copying was a widespread practice. The St. Louis scroll is reproduced complete in color in the 3,000 Years book, and Dick Barnhart gives a good description of it on page 119. So I'll read his long paragraph about it while Ran Chatterjee puts on the appropriate images of sections and details from it that we have. So here we go. Next, please. This is Dick Barnhart writing, quote, "Fish swimming and falling flowers is a quiet symphony of rhythm and movement, the effect of which is attained precisely through the many ways the painter creates the impression of swimming, darting, drifting fish, and schools of fish. It opens with a branch of blossoming peach flowers that touches the water like the entrance to the fabled peach blossom spring, and informs us that in some important way we are about to enter a realm where time stands still. A small school of slender fishes fights for the bits of pink blossoms that fall into the water, and one fish swims quickly away with its prize while the others circle and fleetly follow. Below we see the water grasses that grow from the mud, and here and there a shrimp or other crustacean. The dense, sheltering thicket of water plants that follows is a breeding ground for the large fish that surround it. Swarms of newborn fish are visible, and above on the surface of the water, flat, brilliant green lily pads appear. In the third section, a garden of water plants becomes the center of focus, a bouquet formed of exquisitely subtle tonalities of ink wash and pale green and brown colors. Suddenly, a brilliant orange goldfish appears, then jade green leaves and more goldfish, as the composition comes to a close with the appearance of the patriarchal figures in the watery world, several huge carp, who appear to the lesser fishes we have seen as kings to their kingdom." End quote. That's the end of Dick Barnhart's very good passage on this painting. He goes on to write about how the dream of what he calls losing all memory of things deep in the waters of the rivers and lakes becomes the always desired but rarely attained dream of a busy official. And he says, "Before Liu Cai, there was no visual correspondence to this ideal, and it quickly became a popular theme in painting. 30 scrolls by Liu were in the government collection by 1120, and fish subsequently acquired many other symbolic forms and functions," end quote. Okay, to include this section on paintings of fish, I want to show briefly a handscroll painting in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, discussed and reproduced by Wenfeng in his Beyond Representations book, pages 380 to 383. This is a signed work by, and I really mean by this time, an artist named Zhou Dongqing. His inscription at the end of the scroll includes a date corresponding to 1291, so it's just over the edge into the beginning of the Yuan Dynasty. I include it here as the first Chinese fish painting known to me that bears a reliable inscription identifying the artist and giving the date. and I want to use it to show how already in that age of Zhao Mengfu and the emergence of literati painting to the forefront, the very nature of the painting was already changing. The main part of his inscription is a poetic quatrain that reads, as translated by Wenfeng, quote, "Not being fish, how do we know their happiness? We can only take an idea and make it into a painting. To probe the subtleties of the ordinary, we must describe the indescribable," end quote. Now, how is this already different from all the fish paintings we've seen up to now? First, the artist not only identifies himself and gives the date in an inscription, but reminds the viewer, somewhat unnecessarily, I think, of the well-known Zhuangzi anecdote in his quatrain. The work contains, then, what are sometimes called the three perfections, painting, calligraphy, and poetry. Michael Sullivan had a book of that title, The Three Perfections. Secondly, it is painted on paper, which was ordinarily used in preference to silk by the scholar amateur artist because the grain of its surface transmits better the subtleties of the artist's brushwork. And finally, it has reduced the power of the work to draw the viewer's gaze down into the depths by flattening the scene, reducing the setting of water plants, making the fish more uniform in size and type. We know a little more about Zhou Dongqing than we do about the others. He was a painter of fish and a friend of the famous scholar general Wen Tianxiang, who had led troops against the invading Mongols and had died in 1283 after being captured by the Mongols and refusing, even under torture, to renounce his loyalty to the Song and change sides. Already then, we are in a profoundly different world than that of the Southern Song Academy we have been following, a world in which personality matters more and painterly skills less, in which the artist asserts himself in other ways than just as a fine painter, in which idea is taking precedence over image. But happily, we still have several more lectures to go before we have to confront that takeover and end this series. And with that observation, I end this section on fish paintings. The next artist, who's really quite important, and one we'll spend a bit of time on, is Ma Hezhi. Ma Hezhi, active in the mid-12th century. Again, Julia Murray, the same person I spoke of earlier, who teaches at the University of Wisconsin, has a very good book on Ma Hezhi, worked on him for years and published this good book, called Ma Hezhi in the Book of Odes, Cambridge University Press, 1993. So I'm going to put one of the pictures on and talk about it at some length about before I really come to talk about the pictures individually. The Book of Odes, first of all, Shijing in Chinese, is the oldest book of Chinese poetry, some 305 pieces in it, dating from the late Shang period, the 11th century BC, up to the late 7th century BC, when it was compiled around 600 BC. It used to be associated with Confucius, but anyway. There are various translations, very scholarly one by Bernard Carlgren, more literary translation of part of it by Arthur Whaley, and so on. Ma Hezhi, the artist of these, was a native of Hangzhou. One source from the early 13th century says that he attained the Jinshu degree, a kind of degree which enabled you to attain high office in the government. That he had this Jinshu degree in the mid-12th century and that he held some high official rank. And if that's true, then he wasn't properly an academy painter, but an official who also painted, perhaps largely as an avocation. Well, it's uncertain whether this is reliable. Julia Murray doesn't really come out solidly on one side of the other, but leaves it open, which is all she can do, anybody can do. But if so, as I say, he could be called in a sense, a literati painter or a scholar amateur, although his works, as we'll see, are done with a very high technical finish. Anyway, the Emperor Gaozong admired his paintings very much and took part with him in a joint project, that is, handscrolls with texts of the poems of the Shijing, also called the Mao Shi because of early annotations by somebody Mao, the Book of Odes anyway, written out by the emperor, and then the illustrations painted by Ma Hezhi. The emperor, according to records, wrote out about 300 of the poems, leaving space for Ma Hezhi to do the paintings. He died before he had finished all of them. Anyway, this was, again, a political project, a part of the claim of legitimacy. But anyway, political. So there are many scrolls of this kind purporting to be from the series that survive in various collections. But again, close copies were made, and it's all but impossible to sort them out now. There's a lot of controversy. Among the strong contenders, I used to use a scroll in the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, quite fine, and one in the Fuji-e Yudin-kan in Japan, in Kyoto, and a scroll in the Palace Museum in Beijing, which we saw when we went there, is quite fine. I won't, as I say, try to distinguish them all or argue which are originals and which are copies. Julia Murray assumes that they were all, in some sense, joint productions. She doesn't try to say this is real and this is copy or whatever, and avoids the question of the hand of the artist. Well, the plan of the paintings, first of all, is really quite old-fashioned. That is, text and pictures alternating, in that sense, like the admonition scroll attributed to Gu Kaiju, that is, in the Liaoning version anyway. No, then the British Museum painting, which you have text and pictures alternating. Deliberately old-fashioned in that way. The figure style, as we'll see when we get in closer, is described as light and fluttery. The brush line used by Ma Hezhi was said to be like willow tendrils or the leaves of orchids. That is, it thickens and thins in this kind of smooth, rhythmic way, swelling and thinning brush line. It's sometimes said that by critics, that he imitated Wu Daozi of the Tang Dynasty, but that probably means nothing more than that he used this kind of drawing with swelling and thinning brushstrokes. He has nothing of the force of Wu Daozi, anything like that. It's rather a matter of delicacy here, and one might say more than a shade precious. He's praised in the literati texts of the Yuan that otherwise do not praise court painting, so he's somehow separated from the regular academy masters as an artist who stands apart from them and somehow above them. His brushwork certainly has the individualized look of being by some particular artist without being personally expressive. It isn't like a personally expressive brushwork in literati painting. There's no gestures, there's no distortion of form for expressive purposes. So it's academic in the end. Now let's go ahead. This is the text and the story and the picture for one. I think this is probably the Beijing version. Anyway, this is the Tianbao Jiouru. Tianbao is an auspicious poem, and it's always illustrated with a red sun and pine trees and mist and tall peaks. There are many paintings of this kind from later periods. Here's two more. As I say, I'm not going to try to show where they are located. You can see here's one with geese flying, some of them perched in a tree and some in the air, and a leafy tree and strange rocks down below. And here you can see this strange brush line, sort of strangely wavering rhythmically of Ma Hezhi. And here another one of rocks in the water and leafy trees and a man standing down below. Well, you often, there were often in these poems, you often find a person standing or is mentioned. The poems often open, that is, with an evocative image that sets the mood of the poem, and Ma Hezhi often or almost always illustrates this. And then the poem goes on to express human emotion, which is harder to depict. You see the person, presumably the person who is reciting the poem, or at any rate, the person who is having this experience that the poem illustrates, a kind of implied speaker. Yes. Next, please. Here's another one with calligraphy and a painting. Now, about the calligraphy, the emperor, Gaozong, admired late Northern Song calligraphy. He admired Mifu and Huang Tingzhen, people like that, Su Dongpo. But in the end, he went back to the what's considered the orthodox tradition of the two Wangs, Wang Xijie, Wang Xianjie, the mainstream tradition in China. And that's what these scrolls are. Quite neat and so on. But which of it was done by Gaozong and which by copyists or court artists, we have no way of knowing. These scrolls, by the way, that I'm showing are all done on silk. Ma Hezhi is also said to have worked on ink on paper, and there are examples in the Freer Gallery, in the Metropolitan, and elsewhere of Ma Hezhi-style paintings, or paintings conceivably by him, that are in ink on paper. Okay, here's one in the Boston Museum, a court scene with lots of figures. This I know is in the Boston Museum because I remember it. And the emperor seated in the upper middle here, surrounded by his ministers and by all the people, paying homage. You can see very well this kind of drawing used for the figure. Every stroke has a kind of thickening and thinning orchid leaf-like character to it. Very formal. It's a very distinctive style, a poetic style, if you will, literary, somehow fitting the literary and very distant sources of the poems. Here are two now for the end. Here's the from the Boston Museum painting, a passage which is almost completely foliage, a river running into the foreground, and then the banks of it with bushes or trees, and all you really see is foliage. Quite remarkable, really. Another section, I think also from the Boston Scroll, in which two woodcutters are seen gazing up into the trees, perhaps hearing something. I should know what the text is that this illustrates, but I don't. What's remarkable about these paintings is the degree to which solid forms in them are dissolved into areas of loose brushstrokes, just on the edge of abstraction, but still reading as passages of tree foliage and other scenery, with the nearer trees still separated in depth from the further ones at the right. A radical move into semi-dissolution of form that stops just short of going all the way. And then another one here, a detail from the scroll in the Yurinkan, Fuji-i Yurinkan, with, again, very loose painting, a stream in the foreground, and it's quite damaged, by the way, but really quite a remarkable style for the time. The whole effect is obviously to dissolve the forms, to dissolve solid form into clouds of particles, leaves or moss, doesn't matter what. It's surprisingly visual treatment. Now, I've talked about visual treatments, things as they are seen rather than as we know them to be, as typical of Southern Sung Academy painting. And this is sort of extreme point of that. That is, it relies on visual phenomena, perception, rather than reproducing, as I said before, what the artist knows is there intellectually. Well, if you want to compare this with Impressionism or even Pointillism in the, you know, 8 centuries later, is it, in the 19th century, go ahead and do. It's not untrue. It's not obviously very different. But it's remarkable anyway for the 12th century. A number of smaller pictures in the style of Ma Hezhi and attributed to him, album leaves and fan paintings, are also to be seen in various collections. I used to own one of them myself, a small fan-shaped painting now in our Berkeley Art Museum with three figures in Ma Hezhi style, probably a fragment from a larger composition. More interesting than that is the painting shown here, another fan-shaped leaf, this one in the Liaoning Museum, with two lines of poetry in the upper left inscribed on it by the early Yuan master Zhao Mengfu, who tells us that it's an evening scene in autumn. The scholar gentleman is seen on the edge of the water, sitting on a tiger skin, leaning on one hand, the other resting on his knee, as he gazes out over the lake or the river. His pot of wine and things to eat are in front of him. His attentive boy servant is standing beside him. The painting is spotted badly with purple mildew damage of a kind that cannot easily be washed out. But both the figures and the landscape display an early and fine version of the Ma Hezhi manner. All right, now we go on to an important handscroll attributed to Ma Hezhi. In addition to the Mauser or Book of Ode scrolls ascribed to him, painted in ink and colors on silk, and accompanied by the texts written in the imperial script, so that these purport to be the actual scrolls made by Ma Hezhi and Emperor Gaozong working together, there are a few painted in ink only on paper. The scroll in the Fuji Yunnan in Kyoto, which we just considered, is one of these. Another is a scroll in the old Freer Gallery collection, bought by Freer in 1919, representing the seventh month from the Odes of Bin, agricultural poems from the Shijing, the classical poetry. It has no signature or seals of the artist or the calligrapher, and it's attributed to Ma Hezhi in a colophon by the Ming artist Wen Zhengming, which I'll quote after showing the pictures. Each painting is about 11.5 inches in height and 20 inches long. The passages of text illustrated are mounted on separate paper before each picture. One of the pairs, the second, doesn't match, and in general it's clear that these are survivors from a larger series. There are, as I say, no signatures or seals of the artist or the calligrapher. Tom Lawton, in his Chinese figure painting book, discusses the scroll at length and calls it Song Dynasty 13th century, which seems about right. He notes that the calligraphy of the texts of the Odes doesn't match the writing of the Emperor Gaozong on the other scrolls. And he notes also that the drawing of the landscape setting and the architectural details is more skillfully done, while that of the figures is what he calls awkward and characterless. That may be a bit extreme. In fact, the figures are not drawn in the Ma Hezhi manner at all, but in a Li Gonglin-like baimiao, or plain line drawing. And the architectural elements are also drawn simply in even line. Only the landscape features, the hillocks and trees and so on, are done in the Ma Hezhi kind of fluctuating brushstrokes. I should add that two early and important handscrolls also illustrating the Odes of Bin are in the Metropolitan Museum, one ascribed to Ma Hezhi and done in ink and color on silk, the other, formerly in the Crawford collection, ascribed to Li Gonglin and painted in ink on paper. Both of them are partly reproduced and discussed in Wen Feng's book Beyond Representation, pages 216 to 225. Okay, the translations of the poems that I will be reading are basically those made by Arthur Whaley. They're taken from the Freer's website on Sung and Yuan paintings. Whaley translated these, also Bernard Carlgren did, James Legg before both of them. There's also a translation even by Ezra Pound and various others. But this is mostly Whaley's. Now we go on to look at the paintings, starting with the first section, which is now, it's been on the screen, the first section in the scroll, in which the text reads this way. In the days of the third we plow, in the days of the fourth out we step, together with our wives and children, bringing hampers to the southern acre, where the inspector of fields comes and is pleased. And indeed, you see the women and children and the man down in the lower right bringing these, bringing things to give to the Lord. And the Lord, larger and looking very proper and so on, surrounded by his servitors to the left of them, and then the farmers doing their various things up above. You notice that, as I said, the landscape piece, the tree in the distance and the bits of earth forms and so on, are the only things that are really done in the Ma Hezhi manner. Okay, the next one. This is the one that's mismatched. The text and the picture don't correspond. The written text on it goes this way. In the days of the first frigid winds, in the days of the second bitter cold, with no robes and no homespun, how will we finish the year? But the text that actually illustrated reads this way. In the seventh month the fire ebbs. In the eighth month they pluck the rushes. In the silkworm month we gather mulberry leaves, taking choppers and hatchets to lop the far boughs and high, pulling toward us the tender leaves. And indeed you see people, two men, gathering mulberry leaves. They are, of course, what you feed to the silkworms in sericulture. So it's very important that you have lots of mulberry leaves. And they have a ladder for climbing the trees and a basket for bringing them back and so on. Well, the trees are drawn in a very fine Ma Hezhi manner. Okay, next. This is then the third in the series. And the text reads, "In the seventh month, the shrike cries. In the eighth month, we spin the thread, the black thread and the yellow. With our red dye so bright, we make robes for our Lord." And it's again a scene of women spinning silk, spinning thread, making the cloth, and so on. We will see other scenes of this kind, sericulture, already have seen or will see in what comes, doing this outside their house. The presence of a large, well, we would call it taihushir, one of these ornamental rocks that are set up in gardens in places like Suzhou, mainly of rich people, is a bit out of place here in the city. You wouldn't find it outside a peasant house, but anyway, it's a very it helps the scene. It's strong. And the architectural drawing, as you see behind, is drawn in a very simple linear way. Next, please. Okay, next one goes, "In the days of the first, we hunt badgers and take those foxes and wildcats to make fur robes for our Lord. In the days of the second, there is the meat where we rehearse our martial skills, keeping for ourselves the wild piglets and presenting to our Lord the three-year boars." Okay. Here is the, you see figures over the edge of the landscape in the upper left. That's a very old feature, as we've seen going back to Tang painting, and archaistic here, certainly. One of them carrying a hawk for hunting, and then you see the Lord on his horse, surrounded by his attendants and people with bows and arrows and so on, and somebody presenting something to him. Maybe it's part of a boar, I don't know, and a little dog down below. And then in the lower right, you see two peasants walking ahead, one of them leading on little leashes for piglets. In other words, they are able to keep the piglets for themselves, but when they catch a big boar, they have to give it to their Lord. Okay, the next one. "In the fifth month, the locust moves its legs. In the sixth month, the grasshopper shakes its wings. In the seventh month, it is in the fields. In the eighth month, it is under the eaves. In the ninth month, it is at the door. In the tenth month, the cricket goes under my bed." So here you see the grasshoppers, crickets, insects, whatever they are. You don't see them actually, but the woman and her boy out in the yard catching them, presumably, and another one inside trying to find the one that's gone under the bed. Okay, very simple landscape setting and architecture. An interesting scene. Okay, the next one. The sixth one. "We stop up their holes and smoke out the rats. We block up the windows and plaster the doors. Oh, my wife and children, the year is now changing. Let us enter and dwell in this house." So you see the people stopping up their house so to keep the cold out, so they can survive through the winter. Somebody, one of the sons, plastering something or fixing the wall, and the woman and the little child, or the man arriving with one of his children and another son, I suppose, bringing two things on a pole over his shoulder. Anyway, getting ready for the cold winter. The next, please. Okay, the seventh. "In the morning we gather reeds, at night we twist rope, and go quickly up on the roof, that we may begin to sow our grain." Okay, and here you see the somebody gathering reeds and another one twisting them into a rope to make rope. This rope twister, by the way, in the same posture, using his foot to stretch the rope between his toes, appears also in a hanging scroll ascribed to Ma Hezhi in the National Palace Museum in Taipei. So it may well be a motif that he himself originated. The trees done in the Ma Hezhi style up top are quite fine. Okay, the eighth and last picture. The text reads, "In the days of the second, we hack the ice with ringing blows. In the days of the third, we bring it into the cold shed. In the days of the fourth, we rise before the dawn, presenting lamb roasts and offering garlic." Well, here you see, this is quite interesting. It's a winter scene, obviously. The river is still frozen, and you see it at the left with the ice cracked, and the men have gathered the ice. You see them with kind of hose from which they hacked it, and are carrying it in baskets and storing it, not in a shed, you know, the cold shed mentioned in the poem, but in a cave. And this is the way they would keep things cold. It was a kind of a outdoor refrigerator, cooler anyway. And you would put things in there with the ice, and it would stay, it would help them to stay fresh and edible through the warmer season. Notice, by the way, in this one, the seal on the upper right, the seal reading Junyu Zhongbi, to be treasured among the myriad jades, which is the seal of the Jin Emperor Zhongzong, which, if it's genuine, makes the scroll at least as old as his time, which is late 12th, early 13th century. Finally, for Ma Hezhi, I'm going to show a handscroll, the Red Cliff. This is another, I showed one earlier in this lecture by an artist named Wu Yuanzhi. Here's one by Ma Hezhi. And here are the just old black and white reproductions, the first section and the later section of the scroll, reproduced so they stretch across the whole space. And again, we see at the beginning a foreground, a bit of shore with grass and trees, and then the river with the swirling water and shooting foam. And then at the end, we see the cliff of the water with trees. Okay, here we go. Here are I have some pretty good slides you made from the original. This is a scroll that I remember really admiring and enjoying, and I'm glad to have good enough slides to show. Because here is where Ma Hezhi's poetic manner really fits and provides a strange and very special experience as you roll it. Here at the beginning of the scroll, here's the shore with bits of vegetation, bits of wind-blown reeds, and then distant hills very softly shown with just brush strokes. And then as we go to the middle of the scroll, next please, here is the middle of the scroll, and here we see the familiar boat with Su Dongpo and his two guests. And here, instead of a single boatman, we have the boatman at one end with his oar, and we have two servants down at the other end. They're all turning to look at the cliff in this case, instead of eating their late night dinner or whatever. So as this brings our attention to the cliff, and all around them, here's the detail, all around them is quite beautiful painting of waves, which perfectly suits the style of Ma Hezhi, and makes this a very special viewing experience here in close, looking rather low class and somehow looking up rather concerned and holding the end of his oar under his arm. And here is Su Dongpo, seen, he's the major figure, turning, looking very dignified, and looking toward the cliff. He's musing on the cliff. He believed wrongly, it turned out, that this was a place where a famous battle had been fought, and he was remembering this battle. Well, he got the wrong place, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't hurt the poem any. And here in the base, in the bottom of the boat, you see the pot of wine and the food and so on. And quite wonderful painting of the waves around it. At the lower left here, where the boat is stirring up the waves. And then further on, quieter waves. And then, as we come to the end of the scroll, here's a slide of the end, the water running over the rocks. This, by the way, is one of the wonderful bits of the poem, the water running over the rocks near the shore, and an old bare tree, and the water beating against this cliff, drawn in Ma Hezhi's wonderful drawing. Now here we, oh, here's a detail. Ah, that's wonderful. Ma Hezhi really is at his best. He is an artist of real poetic sensitivities, and a really individual and very moving style at its best. I really, myself, prefer this to the Mauser scrolls, but it's a matter of opinion. They're all fine. Okay, now then, here we go. Here is something quite different. This is something outside the academy. Okay, now we come to a scroll which is one of my own favorites of all Southern Song painting, or Chinese painting generally. This is the scroll of the dream journey on the Xiao-Xiang rivers. It's now in the Tokyo National Museum, acquired, I think, early in the 20th century from China. A famous painting there. It has a wrong attribution based on a fake signature at the end, a wrong attribution to Li Gonglin. Li Gonglin, the major literati painter whom we saw works by or attributed to in the 8th lecture. And the various writings on the scroll, such as the inscription by Dong Qichang, you see partly here at the far right, are all taken to be a Li Gonglin painting and praise it as that. It was owned by Xiang Yuanbian. Dong Qichang was part of a kind of a tutor in his household for a while, saw his paintings. Xiang Yuanbian seals are on it. Gao Shiqi, his bamboo window seal is here, another 17th century collector, and so on, not to speak of the Shenlong Emperor. So this painting went into great collections in the late period, but it went in because it was attributed to Li Gonglin, not because of what it was. Now we come to what the painting really is. We know from one of the inscriptions that, in fact, the artist was an artist named Li, 12th century, anonymous 12th century, really, from Shucheng in Anhui province, painting in the 1160s. Li Gonglin was from there, which allowed them to make this wrong attribution to him and to interpolate this inscription at the end, which we'll see. As I say, it's in the Tokyo National Museum. In the inscription, the artist is referred to simply as Li Sheng, or Mr. Li, in one of the early colophones. The earliest colophone is dated 1170. So the painting was probably done in the 1160s, and we know it was done for a Buddhist monk commissioned by him, according to the inscription. So the painting is, in some sense, a professional work. We would know this, I think, anyway, from the sheer technical accomplishment of it. This isn't the way the amateurs paint, not the way they can paint. Li Gonglin couldn't touch it. And as I say, it was preserved, really, and commanded a kind of near worship in later times because of the Li Gonglin Association. Okay, other people can differ on that appraisal, but it's mine anyway. Okay, now, here we go, the beginning of the scroll, distant hills, misty hills in the distance. I have pretty good slides, except they've been badly treated, and there are bad smudges and scratches and so on them. I photographed it long ago, decades ago, in the Tokyo National Museum. So I'll show my slides, but I will apologize for the smudges and scratches and all the rest. Here at the beginning, you can see, as I say, the writing on the mounting by Dong Qichang of the 16th, early 17th century, and seals, famous people, and distant hills. Now, the next, please. Here is the second section, and we continue without really much happening. And you wonder, why is this going to be such a wonderful painting? Well, wait and see. Great big seal of the emperor, Shenlong period, 18th century. And a little bit in the far distance, you can see, if you look very hard, you can see what is probably a building silhouette. And you can see a boat with people just to the right and a little bit below the far distance. But look at this a thing of trees in the foreground. It doesn't look like so much here, but let's go and look at it in a detail. Now, here's the detail. Now you begin to see why this is a wonderful painting. Imagine trying to paint this, accomplishing this kind of range of ink tonality within these small areas, and doing it in a way that doesn't show any calligraphic hand of the artist. That isn't what the painting is about at all. instead, it's a rendering of how things would look seen from a distance. But we're back to this idea of perception rather than intellectual understanding. Okay, and here, let me put beside it a slide, one of my Huangshan slides of pines and mist, just to remind you of what things look like in the mist. Well, it isn't really like the Xiao-Xiang picture, but at least you can see how in the foreground a pine tree is readable with its branches and so on, and then they become progressively dimmer as you go back and so on. But a bunch of trees seen in the mist, as rendered by this artist, is really quite wonderful. Okay, on. Here in a further section, and you notice, by the way, that where the joins of the paper are, people put their seals, especially this Gao Shu Qi, a great 17th century collector. And this is so the painting can't be separated. People would sometimes take parts of the painting and mount them separately and sell them separately and so on. But the seal somehow authenticates the joins and shows it to be all there. Well, okay, we're coming to a land mass finally. Quiet painting still. And here are the great big seal of this 18th century emperor and his writing. Oh, he writes and writes. He wrote hundreds or thousands of inscriptions. Probably had a lot of them composed for him. Doggerel rhymes and anyway. And then you see the main part of the painting. And what it is a quite wonderfully composed scene of hills or ridges curving, interlocking, moving together, moving back, and rivers flowing or streams flowing in valleys, and groves of trees growing smaller as you go back, and dimming as you go back. Anyway, this is a section of the main section of the hand scroll, as complex in its way as a section of a great hanging scroll, because there's so much going on in it, as we'll see. It's, as I say, strongly composed, but also quite wonderful in detail, as we'll see as we go on. Okay, anyway, now here's the section just before we reach that main place. let me talk a bit now about, while we gaze at this, about the Xiao-Xiang region. As I've said before, I think, and I hope I won't have to say it again, the person to read on this about the Xiao-Xiang and all the poetry connected with it is Alfreda Merck. She has done wonderful studies of Chinese poetic painting and poetry in painting and Song Dynasty poetic themes in painting. some of the best of this was associated with an artist who, I think I said this in the previous lecture, whose work doesn't survive, but there is a 12th century painting of the Xiao-Xiang Eight Views in the Princeton Art Museum that she wrote about. Okay, anyway, and I will show more Xiao-Xiang pictures at the end of this course. Great paintings done by two Chan or Zen Buddhist artists, Mu Qi and Yu Jian. At any rate, the Xiao-Xiang region properly is more a region than a single place, is the convergence of two rivers named the Xiao and the Xiang in Hunan province. In practice, it refers to southern Hunan area up to Lake Dongting, which is north of Changsha. This is lush, watery scenery associated in a literary way with the famous poet Chu Yuan, active from around 343 to around 278 BC. He committed suicide, you know the story. Okay, now in this painting, the painter captures the sense of distant contemplation of this kind of landscape. That is the experience of gazing at the scenery through atmosphere at a distance. So it can be abbreviated. And as you come in closer, you see there's quite a bit going on in the painting you don't see at first. Now there is a tree grove in the middle right here, and just to the left of it, a pathway which eventually goes across a bridge. And you see a figure there on the bridge. And the figure is arriving at a cluster of houses among the trees over here in the middle left. Well, the painting is full of details of this kind, hidden, partly hidden, and only visible, as in fact it would be in real visual experience, as you look longer and you begin to see things you didn't see at first. Okay, then a bit further on, here's the beginning of that main group of ridges or hills that make up the main part of the painting. And here you can see in the foreground houses with actual figures. And you see them very dimly and simply. Thatched houses, figures in a kind of village here. And again, really wonderful drawings of tree groves. Now the marvel of this is that you see these not as as they would be understood, as they might be painted by a early painter, tree plus tree plus tree, but seen as a whole grove, a visual unit, a tree grove, wonderfully, wonderfully caught. God, you can't think of anything like this in European art until we get way, way up into the 19th century or so. Okay, anyway, I won't keep going that, making that point. It's pretty obvious. Now let's see. Oh, here, closer up. Yeah, here's the village. Somebody carrying something over his shoulder. Somebody here directing a servant, I guess, outside the houses and thatched houses and seen through the trees. You, as I say, imagine painting this. Imagine somehow laying on the ink in such this somewhat blurry way that reproduces the experience of gazing through atmosphere at the scenery. Okay, next. Now here's the main section again. I'll leave this on while I read something. This kind of achievement was not entirely unrecognized in its time. A late 12th century writer, who's quoted by Max Luhr, page 210 of Luhr's book, writes this, quote, "Mountains in rain, mountains in sunshine, the painters have no difficulty in depicting them, but phenomena like fair weather turning to rain, or rain about to cease, the fog at night, the mist at evening as it parts and then closes again, a vista obscured, appearing no sooner than being submerged into nothingness. These are difficult to depict, unless it be an artist of marvelous ability, recognized in the world, one whose concepts transcend the ordinariness of things. He certainly cannot attain it," end quote. That's the translation by Luhr, I guess. Anyway, but the point is the painter of this wasn't recognized. He's known only through the early colophons on this marvelous work. And the painting itself was preserved and highly praised only because it was falsely turned into the work of Li Guanglin, an artist who, for all his other strengths, and I'm not denying them, was way short of the ability to paint something like this. Shimada reproduced in this painting, associated with Mio Run. But again, Mio Run couldn't touch this. He couldn't begin to. He didn't have that kind of sheer ability. Okay, this is, I'm being biased, but I'm being biased in a way I think that fits the paintings. Chinese collectors were deliberately gullible in accepting misleading attributions and signatures. They wanted big names. They wanted a Li Guanglin painting. They didn't want a painting by some anonymous guy in the mid-12th century working in Shushan named Mr. Li. C.C. Wang always told me, I remember very well, if it's a great painting, then it has to be by a great artist. And by the great artist, he meant some recorded great artist. So it had to be by a big name, or else he wasn't interested. I've taken a very different view. It seems on the basis of the paintings as they were preserved, and the way I'm presenting them anyway, some of the best are in fact done by artists we don't know a thing about. Well, you see how the artist carries us back from the foreground with relatively clear and distinct tree groups and detail and so on, the village down here on the lower right, carries us back through progressively dimmer and less detailed passages, systematically. I'll put beside that another of my Huangshan photos, which brings this out very well, I think. From the lower right, where you see a rock and tree, very detailed, or around the bottom on the lower left, going back to progressively dimmer and progressively less detailed passages. So this, our artist is presenting something that is visually true, among other things. That's not all he's doing, but that's one of the things he's doing. We can believe it. Now, again, to go in and look a bit closer. Here in the foreground of that section, a little pavilion by the water again, and further back, a boatman in a boat, and further beyond that, a bridge. Again, something survives of that more you look, more you see thing. Now, here again, this is for the further, the left side, rolling further, of that main mass, and the river flowing out of the distance. And on the left here, sort of middle left, you can see a passage with trees in the foreground and houses sort of built up the hillside. And then on the left over here, we see a boat with figures. I'll show details of those. Here, the same thing up closer. The grove of trees and a ridge behind that winds upward and connects with ridges behind. And then on the hillside is this passage of houses coming in still closer. Shoreline, the boat off on the left, and the space of the painting is really very convincing. The artist doesn't create space in complicated ways in the way a Six Dynasties artist or some earlier artist might do. He does it all very easily, with just effortlessly. The whole painting seems effortless. The amount of actual technical skill it would require to paint such a picture is another matter, but he doesn't give the effect of showing off at all. No fancy brushwork, no expressive brushwork. No, look at me, what a great artist I am. Ah, absolutely none of that. Okay, here we are. Here's the passage of the roofs of houses seen through the trees, through these dim, progressively dimmer trees. Here's the boat, by the way. The boatman, three people in the boat, very simply drawn because you're seeing it in a distance. And then the painting sort of goes off into the distance. This is the next full section of it. The boat down below here at the right, and then the shoreline going back, with bridges and boats and houses and all the rest into the far distance. And the painting quietly fades away. The later part of it, by the way, is damaged. You can see these big gray hanging things in the top. That's where the painting has been damaged and new paper has been set in. So there's part of it missing up there. But the hills disappear into the distance, way back. Oh boy, way back into the distance. Ewig, ewig. That's the end of Das Lied von der Erde by Mahler. Very soft, quiet ending. Off into the distance. No real ending, as if it could go on forever. Oh well. Now, and even here, there are little bits of detail. More boats, which you see until the very end. And the painting quietly fades away. Here's a close-up of part of that distant passage, and you can see really quite a lot going on. A boat, people in the village, a number of figures, houses, and all the rest of it. So if you look hard, you find it, but basically it's just disappearing. And then here, further back, no houses, big seals, more damage at the top, and then here's the end of the painting. Blank. The artist, in other words, let it trail off into absolute blank paper. And our Qianlong Emperor obliges by writing a big, awful inscription here and putting his seals all over, and other collectors put their seals all over, and the Emperor writes about it as a Li Gong Wen painting and great praise for it. And then at the left middle here is the fake, the spurious, interpolated so-called Li Gong Wen signature saying, "This is my dream journey on the Xiao-Xiang picture. Bosher, that's Li Gong Wen. Painted it for Yun Gu," and so on. Okay, well, that, as I say, is why the painting was preserved. So we can be glad that it's there, even though it somewhat despoils the end of the painting for us. Okay, enough. That's a great work. I'm so glad to have good slides and be able to talk about it. It's a pinnacle of one direction in Southern Song landscape that we'll see a few other works of the same kind, and we'll see it going still further in Chan or Zen painting on the late Song. Okay, the next, please. A scroll that was paired with this in historic times, but vastly less interesting, also an old attribution to Li Gong Wen that doesn't mean anything, is a painting, a long hand scroll, now in the Freer Gallery, old collection, A River in Shu. Freer Gallery 16, from 1916, acquired late in Freer's lifetime. A panoramic landscape of the Yangtze River is what it is. It's kind of a picture map, and it's interesting in its way, not very exciting as a picture, as a painting, but showing actual places along the Yangtze River from way up. Shu is, of course, Sichuan, so we're seeing the upper reaches of the Yangtze River, where it begins in Sichuan. This is an anonymous, maybe late Song work, hard to say, as a picture map. And interesting is that. Here's another section of it with the misty hills along the river and so on. It begins, as I say, up in Shu, and then as we come down, the next place, we have a long section. Now, there's more going on and more villages and places, and the artist or somebody writes in labels all the way. And here you can see a pagoda in the lower left and the buildings on a ledge and so forth. Well, it's interesting as a picture map. I had a whole seminar on topographical painting and dealt with picture maps of this kind. I'm adding in here, last minute, because good images came into my possession, an important hand scroll in the Osaka Municipal Museum by a little-known artist named Hu Shun Chun. It belongs here under political themes because it depicts the departure of an official on a mission for the Northern Song Court, and it bears a colophon by the famous prime minister of that time, Tsai Cheng. Such a scroll was no doubt presented to the official as a gift on his departure. Quite a few examples survive from later periods. I treat them in my chapter on meanings and functions in Chinese landscape painting in my book, Three Alternative Histories of Chinese Painting. This scroll is the subject of a very good study by Elizabeth Brotherton, known to her friends as Lulu, and I count myself among her friends. She's the daughter of a very good friend of mine, Joe Brotherton, and although she wasn't properly my student, she sat in on my courses and seminars for a time before she went on to Princeton for the doctorate, and she teaches now at New York State University in New Paltz. Information on her article will be at the end of the handout for this lecture. Now back to the painting. Hu Shun Chun was a painter in the Huizhong Academy. His inscription, a poem signed and with a date corresponding to 1122, is at the left end of the painting. Brotherton makes a good argument that for an earlier farewell painting by Li Gong Lin and its inscription, which are known only now from written records, the painting long lost, while this Li Gong Lin painting and the inscription on it had expressed the literati attitude against government service, the conventional rhetoric of the would-be scholar officials always pretended that they would rather stay home on the farm, even when they were actively seeking office. In contrast to that, Hu Shun Chun and Tsai Cheng, representing the imperial court attitude, glorify official service, praising the official for leaving his comfortable home to go off to bleak and perilous places. And the handscroll, as Elizabeth Brotherton reads it, portrays that idea. Reading it backwards the Chinese way that is, from left to right, at the far left, we see the official's home, set among the trees, rising above the trees, with other buildings nearby, and things all representing a comfortable situation that he's leaving to go on this difficult trip. His understood road, beginning the trip, leads over a bridge and past successively larger and harsher-looking hills, eventually going into, at the far right, a mountain road beneath tall pines. Envoys in this period were frequently sent to negotiate with the Jin or Jurchens in the north, and this official was probably going on such a mission. Now, next please. I bring back to remind you this painting from the previous lecture, a copy, badly worm-eaten, after a composition probably by Wen Tong, a generation or so earlier, that is, the famous bamboo painter. This is a rare example of a landscape attributed to him anyway in the Metropolitan Museum. I bring it back as another example of a landscape composition belonging to a type, this one the landscape of reclusion type, with the recipient's retirement house surrounded by hills at the left and the opening out from the river shore at right, signifying his freedom to move out into the world when he wanted to. Boats moored on the shore to suggest that. This type also is discussed in my Three Alternative Histories article on meanings and functions in landscape paintings. Now finally for this lecture I want to talk about the best surviving example of a set of compositions that exist in a number of versions, and that's the series called 18 Songs of a Nomad Flute, attributed to a Chinese woman named Wenji, who in the Han Dynasty, wasn't it, who was who was married to a Mongol Hunnish Xiongnu, I guess, ruler, and as a kind of political thing, and went off to live with him as the Xiongnu moved through the landscape. Well, paintings of this done of this kind exist in quite a large number. The best that I know is the series in the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, not complete, but presumably, but seeming to be Southern Song or so in date, Academy works. Now, I showed a painting that I thought might really be by a Liao artist in a previous lecture. That's not what we have here. Here we have artists done by Academy masters in the Liao style, just who, for whom they were done or whatever, is an open question. For another version, by the way, see Beyond Representation, Wenfeng's book, pages 209 to 215, a version of the Metropolitan Museum, also old and fine. But I think I take this one as better. The Khitans I've talked about before, called their dynasty the Liao, originally a nomadic people who settled in the regions north of China, Mongolia, Manchuria, down to the site of present Beijing, which became their southern capital. And the Northern Song paid tribute to them to pacify them. They were replaced, succeeded in the north by the Jurchens, the Jin dynasty, and they in turn were conquered and displaced by the Mongols, who eventually founded the Yuan dynasty. That's the end of this course. At any rate, well, paintings of this kind were presumably done for presentation to people who were somehow engaged in what we would call foreign relations, emissaries, and so on, or maybe as gifts to the foreign people. Non-Han people, non-Chinese in that sense. One gets in trouble if one says non-Chinese. I once, way back, talked about Wenji's return to China and got in some trouble. And one of my colleagues told me, you aren't supposed to say return to China because you never left China. Central Asia is part of, oh, God help us, that argument. At any rate, so here we are anyway with a series of quite fine paintings representing this woman who is married to a Xiongnu ruler and goes with him on his nomadic journeys across the steppe, across the outer areas. And you see here, this is one of the Boston series. They have erected kind of cloth fences on posts as windbreaks so they can stand against the cold. And the hut or yurt, actually it's a Mongol word, which they can carry and set up. And at the entrance to it, presumably, you see Wenji. I think that's what's happening. At any rate, and various Liao people standing around. Okay, the next, please. Here's a section of another scroll in the Boston Museum with a river flowing down through it, very flattened. The flattening of the river in this way, which may remind you of the river that flows through the deer in an autumn forest pictures. Both are based on Tang types, Tang traditions. This is a kind of Tang motif. Here are you see Wenji and her husband seated in this building, surrounded by guards, oxen behind, horses, and so forth. Down in the lower part, you see Xiongnu cooking. And this is interesting in itself because one scholar of this, actually is my wife Xingyuan, working on these, points out very rightly that what they are cooking in their pots are great big, like legs of lamb or huge things, not refined cooking. It's as though, in other words, it's the Chinese view of how the Liao probably, or how the Xiongnu probably cooked. And in actual paintings from the Liao themselves, like wall paintings that have been found, it's very different. Cooking is much more refined and true to the way they really did it. This is just an outsider's view. Now, going on, then the scene, the most moving scene, here I have a black and white reproduction of it, but better probably is this color reproduction, yeah, here, in which Wenji is leaving her husband. She is ransomed. She returns to China. She is sort of bought back, so to speak. And here you see she is standing with her husband and with her child. She has to leave not only the husband, but her child. She's borne by him. Here in the detail on the left, you see the chariot that's going to carry her back. Behind are the Shengnu buildings and a hut and so forth. Okay, anyway, very moving, dramatic narrative scenes. And they are done to accompany these quite wonderful poems attributed to Wenji, which have been variously translated. And then in the last scene here, this is the last scene, she returns to China, and here in the streets of Chang'an, presumably, you know, where would it be? Yeah, anyway, outside her house, you see her chariot in the street, and all the people gathering, and all kinds of things going on. And then inside, she is presumably entering the entryway of the house. Well, it's a picture full of incident, beautifully painted, worth a lot of study, and I'm only doing it rather briefly here. All right, that's all for this part of the lecture. I'll go on in the next part to talk about, in a general way, the Southern Song Academy and the masters who worked in it.